Now, you make the point in your piece that both parties are essentially rotten in some respect now. And I think certainly that is the sense of a lot of Americans out there who are seeing our government basically become more or less dysfunctional, and certainly dysfunctional from the perspective of the needs of a lot of Americans. But you make a distinction between the almost the generic rottenness of the Democratic Party and the truly rottenness, I guess, of the Republican Party. Just give me a snapshot of that distinction.
Well, I think by reading the piece, you see some of the aspects of it. The Republicans have sort of taken on this sort of tripartite platform of plutocrats, theocrats, and millocrats. However, that does not let the Democrats off the hook. As James Fallows, the Atlantic writer, said actually when he was commenting on my piece, that the parties don't have sort of offsetting foibles that kind of balance out in some sort of harmonic convergence. Their operational pathologies make each other's failings worse.
All right. Well, let's talk about, I mean, first off, let's talk about this idea that you write that the crackpot outliers of two decades ago have become the virtual center of the Republican Party. Give me a sense of when you first came to the Hill. Well, you know, why were you a Republican, and at what point did you start to see the Republicans drift from those principles that drew you to that party?
Well, actually, in the early 70s, I was put off by the left wing of the Democratic Party because I saw this sort of identity politics, this kind of talk from some of the outliers there about, you know, we're going to take it to the streets and so forth with the implicit threat of violence. We're seeing all that street theater and histrionics and extremism and refusal to compromise now in the Republican Party. And not only that, it has become institutionalized. I guess the thing is, although I'm politically independent, I consider myself somewhat conservative in my sort of general outlook on life. But conservatism, as I understand it, has something to do with Edmund Burke's belief in tradition and moderation. Right-wing radicalism is not conservatism.
And you write that the Republicans have become more like an apocalyptic cult. Explain that to me.
Well, I think it became more evident to me, or at least it manifested itself in daily headlines, with the whole business over the debt ceiling crisis. It was kind of, despite the fact that Wall Street was warning, you really don't want to do this, they were saying, bring it on. We don't think it's so bad, and if it is, so what? And that was Michelle Bachmann, who's, you know, not only a member of Congress, duly chosen and sworn, but also a presidential candidate saying that.
And you suggest in your piece that this is not coincidental. In other words, this is not simply a case of an ideology leveraging the contradictory rules of our government as a way of getting of achieving an end goal. I mean, you actually you lay out that there is almost a transcendent goal that Republicans have that deals with that obstruction actually suits them in another way.
Well, they're not obstructing just for the sake of obstructing or because they don't like this or that bill. When they gridlock Congress, what happens to the public opinion of Congress? It goes down. The last poll I saw had the favorability rating of Congress at a record low 13%. And their belief is, well, we're the party that's against government, so if we trash government, that means we're the relative winners.
What is this Republican Party now? I mean, what do they actually stand for?
Basically money. I would add that the Democrats also seem to stand for money. They're kind of divided among themselves. There's part of them that sort of thinks they have to fulfill the ideals of the New Deal, but they're still beholden to their contributors. Now, the Republicans, on the other hand, embrace that enthusiastically.
And you also mentioned, essentially, there's three principal tenets of the Republican Party of 2011. The first is that the GOP cares solely and exclusively about its rich contributors. Expand on that. I mean, because, you know, this is what is so fascinating to me in that they have a faux populist movement, as you call it, in the Tea Party that really, empirically speaking, is the Republican base and really more or less the same people. How do they manage this, and how do they manifest their sole and exclusive caring about these rich contributors?
Well, we've seen the manifestation of that now that it's the fourth quarter of the football game. Obama's finally started to put some points on the board, or try, with his jobs program and the so-called millionaire's tax or Buffett tax, and you see how adamantly opposed they are. So I sort of rest my case on that, even though that 75%, I think I read today in the Washington Post, of Americans polled on that issue are in favor of increasing taxes on millionaires. Yet somehow they end up voting for Republicans. There's an kind of split-mindedness among the public in that they know what's going on in Wall Street, but there's, you know, been 200 years worth of, you know, the sort of Horatio Alger myth that you can't tear down the rich and accomplish anything, and that, after all, I might win the lottery.
Right.
Most of us, when we look at our chances realistically, understand that's not the case.
And you say the other tenet is they worship at the altar of Mars. What does that mean?
War all the time. If you look at the main spokesman of the Republican Party, they seem to be champing at the bit. They wanted in 2008 to mix it up with Russia over Georgia. You know, that's really smart, getting involved with a nuclear power. They want to intervene in Iran. Iran has been 2 years from a nuclear weapon for the last 20 years, and they've been agitating about that all the time. Unfortunately, since we have a one-and-a-half party system, the Democrats aren't much better.
And so tell me the final tenet, the third one, is essentially a religious one.
Well, that's the large part of their voting base is evangelical or fundamentalist voters, and that's why we have all these attempts to tinker with the Constitution regarding the federal government rather than the states defining marriage and all this sort of thing.
And so, Mike, give me your sense. I mean, where does this go from here? I mean, you were on the Hill for 30 years. What happens now?
I don't know where it goes. I see now the media had succeeded for about 2 weeks in completely ignoring the Wall Street demonstrations. They finally broken through. I'm wondering if there will be a popular movement to say, let's have a little more, you know, traditional social equity in this country.